Hi, you've clicked on to today's tropical tidbit for Friday. Over here in the Atlantic, we have a storm that really jumps out to us now. Hurricane Ophelia is now a Category 3, something that was a little bit unexpected due to some wind shear that she's dealing with. If we look at her core over here, she has a nice eye that's developed here, and she is dealing with dry air. There's outflow boundaries that can be seen racing off to her west, and there's definitely dry air around her west and south sides here, but she is winding up a core. And it's one of those examples of how we understand still not enough about these cores of hurricanes and how they can wind up even in conditions that seem unfavorable, such as all these cirrus clouds that you can see blowing westward to her west. There is wind shear over her right now, and the conditions did not look like they supported a major hurricane, but she has done it. Similarly, sometimes storms just don't strengthen in environments that seem favorable. So there's a lot we don't yet understand. She is a Cat 3 now, really shouldn't last all that long, given that this wind shear does increase as she moves farther north. So she should stay a weak Cat 3 or a Cat 2 as she moves up this way. We'll probably get close to Bermuda, but not a direct hit. If we overlay the NHC forecast, it's about right here. Probably not going to be a direct hit for Bermuda, but they could still get tropical storm conditions on her western side in the northwestern quad. So folks in here should be ready for her, but fortunately, it doesn't look like a direct hit is going to occur here. And she will head on out to sea, and she may affect Newfoundland on her way out, so folks up there should keep an eye on her as Newfoundland, not Newfoundland, Newfoundland should keep an eye on her. Philippe is out here, weak tropical storm, really not doing a whole lot. He's getting caught under the ridge that is currently moving east of Ophelia here, and he will have to take off this way, and eventually he'll curve down, and then he'll get stuck around in here, and then I think he will end up moving out to the northeast. There's been speculation that given the current track, again, I'll lay over the forecast track, showing it coming in here, there's been speculation that it could end up affecting the United States down the road. I firmly believe this is not possible given the idea that troughs are transitioning through the eastern seaboard one after another right now. I really don't think that given the pattern, Philippe is going to be able to avoid curving sharply out to the northeast and out to sea, possibly again close enough to Bermuda for concern, but should not be an issue for the United States at all here down the road. I'm going to take us over to the Western Pacific really quick. We had Typhoon Nesat move through the Philippines, through Luzon, and into China in here. And now look what we have. Another major typhoon less than 4 days ago. Nesat moved over this area, and now 4 days later we have Typhoon Nalji, which is now moving across nearly the same path across Luzon, about to make landfall within the next day or so. A double whammy from two major typhoons for the island of Luzon, most populated area of the Philippines in here. Definitely not a good situation for them. There's also something very interesting to notice about this, and I just couldn't help showing this. Check out this whole area of convection where Nalji is. Nalji came from up here and got kind of cut off from this area up here and then started retrograding southwestward towards where it is now. And notice where it is. It's on the northwest edge of this whole convective glob. And if you look back behind it, there's actually an area of low pressure behind Nalji to the southeast. And if you notice where the cirrus cloud flow is, the typhoon shouldn't be right here. If the real typhoon should be between these two lows, if you take sort of the average of where this low is and where the actual typhoon is, the real typhoon should be in here because if it was in here, notice the cirrus outflow is much better aligned with it if it were actually right here in the center. This is where the typhoon should be. And this implies to me that because it's over here and we have low pressure back to the southeast, it's not as strong as it could have been. This probably could have been closer to a super typhoon if it was actually back here in a location that was more aligned with the divergence field aloft in here. So this is a very interesting setup that I don't see very often in the Western Pacific where there's low pressure in such close proximity, and the typhoon is seemingly not where it's supposed to be, which is very interesting. But the good news is that the cold water wake from Nesat, which is over here, will probably keep Nalji from strengthening too much more before it hit on Luzon, but it is still going to be a bad storm for them. You can see the old track of Nesat here. These colors indicate the sea surface temperature anomalies. Notice that there is a little bit of a cold wake east of the Philippines from where Nesat moved ashore, and Nalji is moving very close to that, very close to the same track as it comes across, and you can say good night when it gets in here. Look at all the cold water from when Nesat expanded and just sat over this area for a few days. Very cold water here, more than 4 degrees Celsius below normal. Nalji will probably find it nearly impossible to maintain anything above a Category 1 typhoon strength moving into China. So China gets the double Category 1 hit. but the Philippines get the double category 3. So bad week for them, and hopefully everyone will be okay over there. Now, staying with the Western Pacific, I want to tie this in to the Atlantic for the next couple of weeks. Notice here, this is the initialization from the European model. Here's Nessat, here's Nalgene. Now, notice the Western Pacific here. If you keep your eyes on the 1012 millibar isobar, here's the one in the northern hemisphere, here's the one in the southern hemisphere. And notice how wide it is. We can see how wide it is over here, and we can see how wide it is over here, because there's a large area of low pressure in the Western Pacific, and right now the MJO is over the area of the world. If we go out to day 10, though, notice what happens. Notice that the width of the 1012 millibar field really shrinks in here. Notice how much shorter these lines are that I just drew compared to the first two. This area of low pressure then is shrinking because pressures overall in here are rising, and the reason they're rising by day 10 is because the MJO is moving on, and it's forecasted to move out of the Western Pacific where it is right now. Octants 4 and 5 and 6 over here support upward motion in the Western Pacific, but as soon as it gets over here into 7 and 8, we start shifting all of that eastward, and you can see where it is right now. Even if we just ignore the forecast, it was lingering around in here for a lot of September, but now you can see it's jumped out in here, and the initial position shows that it's on the move. It's out of the igloo, and now it's out into the Pacific and starting its journey around in here, and as soon as it gets into octant 8, we're going to see the Eastern Pacific get wetter and the Caribbean get wetter, and that's when we might start to see some mischief. And some models are still showing the possibility of this. The Canadian by days 9 and 10 shows a mess of a couple of low pressure systems in the Bahamas, Cuba, and the Caribbean showing a couple of different lows here, 998 millibars southeast of Jamaica. And look what's north of it, a big area of high pressure over 1030 millibars over New England and the eastern United States. And this has been the hallmark of what I've been talking about. Pressures have been rising over the eastern United States. And if you get high pressure up here, you focus convergence down in the Caribbean. And when the MJO comes around in co and coincides with that pattern, then you really have to look out, especially in the month of October. So we're still winding up for something to happen down here, and the models are finally starting to march a little bit forward in the time period. We're now talking about days 8 to 10. We may start to see mischief developing down here. So we're going to have to see if the models can lock onto this a little bit more and keep looking down here for this pattern that will finally come because the MJO is finally on the move. And now that it's finally moving in here, I think we'll see it come across. It's been really slow, and the models have really failed on the timing and forecasting of the timing of this MJO pulse. But now that it's finally moving, I think we'll see this pattern come to fruition. So we shall keep an eye on this area, and of course Ophelia and Philippe, which should both end about to sea, but Bermuda may be the ones getting the short end of the stick, may get affected by these two storms, though hopefully not a direct hit. Ophelia shouldn't be one. Philippe may be a different story down the road, but we will keep an eye on that. All right, that's it for today. Thanks for watching.